Francis Young Husband. Lieutenant Colonel Sir Francis Edward Young Husband, KCSIXE, May 31, 1863, July 31, 1942, was a British Army officer, explorer, and spiritual writer. He is remembered for his travels in the Far East and Central Asia, especially the 1904 British expedition to Tibet, led by him, and for his writings on Asia and foreign policy. Young Husband held positions including British Commissioner to Tibet and President of the Royal Geographical Society. Early life. Francis Young Husband was born in 1863 at Murree, British India, now Pakistan, to a British military family, being the brother of Major General George Young Husband and the second son of Major General John W. Young Husband and his wife Clara Jane Shaw. Clara's brother, Robert Shaw, was a noted explorer of Central Asia. His uncle Lieutenant General Charles Young Husband CBFRS, was a British Army officer and meteorologist. As an infant, Francis was taken to live in England by his mother. When Clara returned to India in 1867, she left her son in the care of two austere and strictly religious aunts. In 1870, his mother and father returned to England and reunited the family. In 1876, at age 13, Francis entered Clifton College, Bristol. In 1881, he entered the Royal Military College, Sandhurst, and was commissioned as a subaltern in the 1st King's Dragoon Guards in 1882. Military career. Having read General MacGregor's book Defense of India, he could have justifiably called himself an expert on the great game of espionage that was unfolding on the steppes of Asia. In 1886 to 1887, on leave from his regiment, Young Husband made an expedition across Asia though still a young officer. After sailing to China, his party set out, with Colonel Mark Bell's permission, to cross 1,200 miles of desert with the ostensible authority to survey the geography. But in reality, the purposes were to ascertain the strength of the Russian physical threats to the Raj. Departing Peking with a senior colleague, Henry E. M. James, on leave from his Indian civil service position, and a young British consular officer from New Chwang, Harry English Fulford, on April 4, 1887, Lieutenant Young Husband explored Manchuria, visiting the frontier areas of Chinese settlement in the region of the Chongbai Mountains. On arrival in India, he was granted 3 months' leave by the Commander-in-Chief Field Marshal Lord Roberts. The scientific results of this travel would prove vital information to the Royal Geographical Society. Young Husband had already carried out numerous scientific observations, in particular, showing that the Chongbai Mountains' highest peak, Bektu Mountain, is only around 8,000 feet tall, even though the traveler's British maps showed snow-capped peaks 10,000 to 12,000 feet tall in the area. Fulford provided the travelers with language and cultural expertise. Young Husband crossed the most inhospitable terrain in the world to the Himalayas before being ordered to make his way home. Parting with his British companions, he crossed the Taklamakan Desert to Chinese Turkestan, and pioneered a route from Kashgar to India through the uncharted Mista Pass. He reported to the Viceroy, Lord Dufferin, his crossing through the Karakoram Range, the Hindu Kush, the Pamirs, and where the range converged with the Himalayas, the nexus of three great empires. In the 1880s, the region of the Upper Oxus was still largely unmapped. For this achievement, aged still only 24, he was elected the youngest member of the Royal Geographical Society and received the Society's 1890 Patron's Gold Medal. In 1889, he made captain, and was dispatched with a small escort of Gurkha soldiers to investigate an uncharted region north of Ladakh, where raiders from Hunza had disrupted trade between Yarkand and India the previous year. Whilst encamped in the valley of the Yarkand River, Young Husband received a messenger at his camp, inviting him to dinner with Captain Bronislav Gromchevsky, his Russian counterpart in the Great Game. Young Husband accepted the invitation to Gromchevsky's camp, and after dinner the two rivals talked into the night, sharing brandy and vodka, and discussing the possibility of a Russian invasion of British India. Gromchevsky impressed Young Husband with the horsemanship skills of his Cossack escort, and Young Husband impressed Gromchevsky with the rifle drill of his Gurkhas. After their meeting in this remote frontier region, Gromchevsky resumed his expedition in the direction of Tibet and Young Husband continued his exploration of the Karakoram. Young Husband received a telegram from Simla, to attend the Intelligence Department, ID, to be interviewed by Foreign Secretary Sir Mortimer Durand, transferred to the Indian Political Service. He served as a political officer on secondment from the British Army. He refused a request to visit Lhasa as an interpreter, disguised as a Yarkandi trader, a cover not guaranteed to fool the Russians, after Andrew Dalglish, a Scots merchant, had been brutally hacked to death. Young Husband was accompanied by a Gurkha escort, celebrated for their ferocity in combat. The forward policy was circumscribed by legal offer to all travelers of a peaceable security crossing borders. Departure from Leh on August 8, 1889 on the caravan route took them up the mountain pass of Shimshal towards Hunza, his aim being to restore the tea trade to Xinjiang and prevent any further raids into Kashmir. Colonel Duran from Gilgit joined him. Young Husband probed the villages to gauge the reception, calculating it was a den of thieves. They ascended the steep ravine. The Hunza was barred to them, a trap was sprung, the parley terms took him inside to negotiate. The nervous reception over, they were all relieved to find safety. Young Husband wanted to know who was waylaying innocent civilian traders, and why. The ruler, Safdar Ali, extended a letter of welcome to his Kashmiri kingdom. The British investigated from whence came the Russian infiltrators under Agent Gromchevsky. Further south at Ladakh, he kept close watch on their movements. Reluctantly, Young Husband dined with the Cossack leaders, who divulged the secrets of their common rivalry. Gromchevsky explained that the Raj had invited enmity for meddling in the Black Sea ports. The Russian displayed little grasp of strategy, but basic raw courage. He betrayed the confidence of Abdul Rahman as no friend to the British. Young Husband tentatively concluded that their possessions at Bukhara and Samarkand were vulnerable. Having drunk large quantities of vodka and brandy, the Cossacks presented arms in cordial salute and they parted in peace. Woefully unprepared for winter, the British garrison at Ladakh refused them entry. Young Husband finally arrived at Galmit to a 13-gun salute. In khaki, the envoy greeted Safdar Ali at the marquee on the Karakoram Highway, the men of Hunza kneeling at their ruler's feet. This was colonial diplomacy, based on protocol and etiquette, but Young Husband had not come for merely trivial discussions. Reinforced by Duran's troops, Young Husband's arguments were to prevent the criminal looting, murder and highway robbery. Impervious to reason though Safdar Ali was, Young Husband was not prepared to allow him to laugh at the Raj. A demonstration of firepower caused quite a sensation, he wrote in his diaries. The British major was disdainful, but content when he left on 23rd of November to return to India, which he reached by Christmas. In 1890, Young Husband was sent on a mission to Chinese Turkestan, accompanied by George Macartney as interpreter. He spent the winter in Kashgar, where he left Macartney as British consul. Young Husband wanted to investigate the Pamir Gap, a possible Russian entry route to India, but he had had to ensure that the Chinese at Kashgar were sorted out, to prevent a tripartite attempt by the Hunza clans. It was for this reason he recruited a Mandarin interpreter, junior officer George Macartney, to accompany his missions into the frozen mountains. They wintered in Kashgar as a listening post, meeting in conference with the Russian Nikolai Petrovsky, who had always resisted trade with Xinjiang, Sing Qing. The Russian agent was well informed about British India, but proved unscrupulous. Believing he had succeeded, Young Husband did not reckon on Petrovsky's deal with the Totai, the Chinese governor of Hunza. In July 1891, they were still in the Pamirs when news reached them that the Russians intended to send troops to note and report with the Chinese and Afghans. At Bozai Gumbas in the Little Pamir on 12 August he encountered Cossack soldiers, who forced him to leave the area. This was one of the incidents which provoked the Hunza-Nagar campaign. The troop of 20 or so soldiers planted a flag on what they anticipated was unclaimed territory, 150 miles south of the Russian border. However, the British considered the area to be Afghan territory. Colonel Yanov, decorated with the Order of St. George, approached his camp to announce that the area now belonged to the Tsar. Young Husband learned that they had raided the Chitral territory. Furthermore, they had penetrated the Darko Pass into the Yashin Valley. They were joined by eager intelligence officer Lieutenant Davison, but the British were disabused by Ivanov of British sovereignty. Young Husband remained polite, maintained protocol but hospitable to the big Russian bear hug. During his service in Kashmir, he wrote a book called Kashmir at the request of Edward Molyneux. Young Husband's descriptions went hand in glove with Molyneux's paintings of the valley. In the book, Young Husband declared his immense admiration of the natural beauty of Kashmir and its history. The great game, between Britain and Russia, continued beyond the start of the 20th century until officially ended by the 1907 Anglo-Russian Treaty. Young Husband, among other explorers such as Sven Hedin, Nikolai Przewalski, Shokhan Walikanov, and Sir Oriel Stein, had participated in earnest. Rumors of Russian expansion into the Hindu Kush with a Russian presence in Tibet prompted the new Viceroy of India Lord Curzon to appoint Young Husband, by then a major, British commissioner to Tibet from 1902 to 1904. Invasion of Tibet and Massacre at Guru. In 1903, Curzon appointed Young Husband head of the Tibet Frontier Commission with John Claude White, political officer of Sikkim, and E.C. Wilton as deputy commissioners. He subsequently led the 1903-04 British expedition to Tibet, whose putative aim was to settle disputes over the Sikkim-Tibet border, but by exceeding instructions from London, the expedition controversially became a de facto invasion of Tibet. About 100 miles, 160 kilometers, inside Tibet, on the way to Gyantse, thence to the capital of Lhasa, a confrontation outside the hamlet of Guru led to a victory by the expedition over 600 to 700 Tibetan militia, largely monks. Some estimates of Tibetan casualties are far higher, inciting other conflicts. Young Husband's well-trained troops were armed with rifles and machine guns, confronting disorganized monks wielding hoes, swords, and flintlocks. Some accounts estimated that more than 5,000 Tibetans were killed during the campaign, while the total number of British casualties was about 5. The British force was supported by King Ugyen Wangchuck of Bhutan, who was knighted in return for his services. The incident, portrayed by Chinese sources as a massacre, embarrassed the British government, which desired good relations with China for the sake of the coastal Chinese trade. Accordingly, the British repudiated the treaty known as the Treaty of Lhasa that Young Husband's services had obtained. In 1891, Young Husband received the Companion of the Order of the Indian Empire, which was upgraded to Knight Commander in 1904, and in 1917, he was awarded the honor of Knight Commander of the Order of the Star of India. He was also awarded the Kaisar I Hind Medal, gold, in 1901 and the Gold Medal of the Royal Scottish Geographical Society in 1905. In 1906, Young Husband settled in Kashmir as the British representative before returning to Britain, where he was an active member of many clubs and societies. In 1908, he was promoted to Lieutenant Colonel. During the First World War, his patriotic fight for right campaign commissioned the song Jerusalem. Himalaya and Mountaineering. Young Husband was elected president of the Royal Geographical Society in 1919, and 2 years later became chairman of the Mount Everest Committee, which was set up to coordinate the initial 1921 British reconnaissance expedition to Mount Everest. He actively encouraged the accomplished climber George Mallory to attempt the first ascent of Mount Everest, and they followed the same initial route as the earlier Tibet mission. Young Husband remained chairman through the subsequent 1922 and 1924 British expeditions. In 1938, Young Husband encouraged Ernst Schaefer, who was about to lead a German expedition, to sneak over the border when faced with British intransigence toward Schaefer's efforts to reach Tibet. Personal life. In 1897, Young Husband married Helen Augusta Magniak, the daughter of Charles Magniak, MP. Augusta's brother, Vernon, served as Young Husband's private secretary during the expedition to Tibet. The Young Husbands had a son who died in infancy, and a daughter, Eileen Young Husband, 1902 to 1981, who became a prominent social worker. From 1921 to 1937, the couple lived at Westerham, Kent, but Helen did not accompany her husband on his travels. In July 1942, Young Husband suffered a stroke after addressing a meeting of the World Congress of Faiths in Birmingham. He died of cardiac failure on July 31, 1942 at Madeline Lee's home post greenhouse, at Lychett Minster, Dorset. He was buried in the village churchyard. Spiritual life. Biographer Patrick French described Young Husband's religious belief as one who was. Ultimately, he became a spiritualist and premature hippie who had great faith in the power of cosmic rays, and claimed that there are extraterrestrials with translucent flesh on the planet Altair. During his 1904 retreat from Tibet, Young Husband had a mystical experience which suffused him with love for the whole world and convinced him that men at heart are divine. This conviction was tinged with regret for the invasion of Tibet, and eventually, in 1936, profound religious convictions invited a founder's address to the World Congress of Faiths, in imitation of the World Parliament of Religions. Young Husband published a number of books with what one might call New Age themes, with titles like The Gleam, being an account of the life of Nijasvabhava, Sud. 1923, Mother World, In Travail for the Christ That Is to Be, 1924, and Life in the Stars, an exposition of the view that on some planets of some stars exist beings higher than ourselves, and on one a world leader, the supreme embodiment of the eternal spirit which animates the whole, 1927. The last drew the admiration of Lord Baden-Powell, the Boy Scouts founder. Key concepts consisted of the central belief that would come to be known as the Gaia hypothesis, pantheism, and a Christ-like world leader living on the planet Altair, or Stellar, exploring the theology of spiritualism, and guidance by means of telepathy. Young Husband allegedly believed in free love, freedom to unite one and how a man and a woman please, marriage laws examined as a matter of outdated custom. One of Young Husband's domestic servants, Gladys Aylward, became a Christian missionary in China. Fictional portrayal. The Ingrid Bergman film The Inn of the Sixth Happiness, 1958, is based on Gladys Aylward's life, with Ronald Squire portraying Young Husband. Works. Young Husband wrote 26 books in all between 1885 and 1942. Subjects ranged from Asian events, exploration, mountaineering, philosophy, spirituality, politics and more.